Messing up a bit there, eh? Okay, it's all a bit of a catastrophic setup today. Oh, bear with us. The microphone's so delayed. Any viewers that we did have would have disappeared with that beginning, but we probably didn't have any anyway. So let's take, we've still got the music on. Let's fade that out and stop it. Bear with us, we're just gonna realize we didn't have the webcam on. This picture might be better. That's really dark now. Is there any way to stop live and go live again? Oh, well, we can just keep doing this. Bear with us. We're going to put the screen down to see if we can adjust the lighting. Okay, we'd like to start all of that all over again. But we're not going to.
We'd like to start all of that all over again.
You're not sure. Are the cards going to be able to be seen?
I'm not sure.
Oh, we haven't got the light.
At least we're here and live and showing up.
Does that help on the cards? Is that better? That one.
Is that better?
That one. Let's go for that one. So that kind of helps, doesn't it? Hides a bit of the glare. If we do this. Can you tell that we're not tech savvy? So we'll leave that like that. We'll just leave it like that. And we'll calm and we'll settle. We'll put the cards away because we didn't get a chance to shuffle them.
Have a little
slip grid. We put on daring red lipstick. Be brave and courageous. We're planning ahead. So we've shot a few of our, we did the shuffling and shot a few of our daily Liffruma, which is this pile here. We were going to take a photo, but we've been very disorganized. But then that's what we're learning to get towards in all our states, how to have healthy time management and be organized. And this is the practice learning ground, showing it live firsthand, showing that you don't need to be perfect. Imperfection is better. No one wants to see anyone being perfect. But if you can see where we've started with imperfection, it gives others then to courage to start. At least that's how we perceive it and experience it. And you hear people telling you about their story, but it makes, for us, it makes more sense if you can actually show them rather than just tell them. And so that's what we're doing. Plus, we needed to do that in lots of ways just for ourselves to be a witness. So this is going to be the starting blurb that we have before we get into the Liffruma cards to flush out any of the verbal diarrhea. And there's the flush and the diarrhea there. We didn't really plan that one. Well, we don't. We're with verbal diarrhea. You don't plan diarrhea, do you? Oh, dearie me. So we've got a red necklace here, which we might untangle in a minute as well. And one of us has got the diary out, I think, to show you the stickers. So we had an Amazon delivery today, and in our diary, rather than writing words, as we're strengthening them, which naturally, so we don't always have the energy to write words. Numbers. So there's the coloured stickers on the box, Amazon boxes that go in our diary. And they've been blue and green. And we might have even had yellow before. We don't remember. But they've been pink the last few lots over the last month or two. And then today we had a delivery and they were yellow. And that excited us because we're on the yellow colours today. As you can tell from the banner, yellow and red. And as you can tell by our top and the cardigan we did have on and our lipstick. So the sensory systems that are strong at the moment for certain collectives are the olfactory, your nose, your sense of smell, and the colour visual sensory system. This means that so many synchronicities and alignment again. So like when we did our, so that's why we ended up being late, because we couldn't do the something that wanted to be done on our phone, because we normally do the daily Liffruma on Zanoni Snowflake on our phone. Our Litlands do it. But we've been attempting to do stuff over the computer, and then one of them thought they might be able to do something on the computer on the new editing software, but couldn't do it in the end. And plus our phone was running out of memory storage. So, I don't know, there's a whole pile of stuff that went on them with the hard drive and putting stuff on and saving it. So we can finish off our tuning fork shorts for Joy to Coco on the tuning fork healings that we spent like over a whole day, about 11 hours in one day, just on that one short. There's a lot of time and energy being put in lately. So there we go, Liffruma. We've got our little black beaded shungite beaded necklace, which we've kind of put in the camera up there so we can see where the center is down here, because it's not directly in front of us. So, and then we had food, vegetables that we got from our real food box delivery, and a few courgettes, peas, purple peas, purple potted peas, yellow peas, and green peas. So it must be 1 to 2 or sugar snaps that we haven't done anything in the garden really. And then some broad beans from the garden and some broad beans from our real food box seasonal fruit and veg delivery, with some quinoa to try and get all the nutrients and 9 essential amino acids, 9 being the number of the day actually, for the daily Liffruma today was 45. There was, what is it, about a butterfly. So behind us there, you can actually see in the bottom right, there's some writing of this batik behind. This batik, it's actually kind of like the world card, isn't it? We got that done on Tiaman Island in off the southeast coast of Asia, Thailand. So you say Tiaman Island on the southeast coast, off the southeast coast of Thailand, where we did our paddy and advanced paddy. Oh yeah, so we did the advanced paddy, means you can dive down 30 meters. So we did that one. So we're bringing in the depths of the water and we're bringing pressure. That's been a theme that's come up today, over the last few days actually. And that was the daily Liffruma card yesterday. It was about the depths and pressure. We had an amazing ice cry with Steph. We did a ink blot, purchased an ink blot with her, because the last live and here, a lovely subscriber donated us some money. And so we, the Litlands chose to spend it on that. And that's been incredible for connections. It's going to take us a while to go through it. We'll probably give a box opening when it actually arrives, and maybe even attempt to do a live Oh, you've done one more. You wanted to put your nail varnish on. Well, we have to be more prepared if we're going to put nail varnish on like that. challenging to focus at the moment. Lots going on between us. Whew. So, all synchronicities, all alignments. It's the happiness is like a butterfly. The more you chase it, the more it loads you. But if you turn your mind to other things, it'll come sit quietly on your shoulder. So the shoulder came up. Now, this is big for us because of our collarbone and the left shoulder that's going up, the collarbone and the pain that's going on as it rearranges and structures all of that. Structure coming into things because the structural alignment, the structural integrity, it kind of comes from the bones. The bones are the strength and the support, but it's the ligaments, and the ligaments hold the bones in place like guide ropes. So the ligaments need to be functioning properly to hold the bones in place. And for us with our Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, the connective tissue disorder, a malfunction of collagen protein, and so therefore we've noticed it affects the ligaments the most in us. But this is all that we, from all of our research, our knowledge and everything we've done, we've got the some of us that have certain belief systems that we can regenerate all this. And so that's the journey that we've been going on. Although the clarity of being able to vocalize that through our conscious mind in words like we're doing now, this is, it's happened between us all, bits here and there, but no real organized structure. And so that's what we're growing towards. And this is ShintoSEYE, the Shinto yoga experience. Shinto with Shinto self-empowerment, Shinto's being Shinto self-empowerment. And Shinto, we originally thought it meant to just be being the human being rather than the human doing. But it actually stems, it's a Japanese religion, Shintoism, and it's the nature spirits within everything, or the spirit within everything, or God that resides within everything. It's the spirit in the rock, in the water, in the trees, in the plant, in the mineral, in the person, in the food. And I suppose in any building and book, we're not sure on the depth. Well, some of us have done some reading on it, but we don't have access to that at the moment, obviously. So, just before kind of coming on as well, see, it's not that we're listening to Eve, but we watched The Last Push from Joanna Jinton in Sweden, and she's in North Sweden, but she's not quite in the north. But from the end of May to the end of July, so for like 2 months, the sun doesn't set, but it goes below the horizon where she lives. So there's a so you don't see the sun, but if you go further north, the sun's always up. But then you have that period where it's like that in winter as well. So you have 2 months in winter when you never see the sun. So there's the extremes. So I think what's happening here is we're talking about the extremes of the oscillation. And for us and our emotions, it's about settling down that settling down the extremes. I don't know what the idea was with this. I think one of us had the want to untangle the red threads because we're on red and yellow, the red color healing. And so because everything around us is in symbolic of and a reflection of what goes on inside us, then this, and this is also how our little ones have taught us for our manifestations. So for the ones of us that don't have words, and when we were hearing about people talking about how to manifest, and a lot of it revolves around words and what you want and this, that, the other, then there was kind of this added stress and worry, and it's like, well, we don't know what we want, we don't have, or we know what we want but we don't have the words for it, or we all want different things, so if we all want different things, we're not going to be able to get what we want because we all want different things within this one body. But that's where then it was kind of like, I suppose, the scientist in us, the mathematician, we have to get to those fundamental frequencies or go so deep that we find the fundamental frequencies that overlap and connect us all, and the language that overlaps and connects us all. And for that, it's frequency. It's the energetic. So we always work, did stuff in the physical because that's what we're taught in society.
It's frequency.
That didn't serve, or it served us for certain knowledge and certain experiences, but it actually kind of, it caused more pain and more dissonance. We were going against our own natural, the natural integrity or the natural grain of the wood, because we had never been experienced or taught any of that, as many don't in societal ways or in the academic world. So the red's the root chakra, the longest wavelength, the slowest wavelength. This is our way of doing all this talking and this chatting before is our way of connecting in, of purging out the stuff that needs to be purged out to start with, so that we can then become an integral, clear channel for the reading that's about to commence. And so we don't really know what's kind of flowing out of our mouth. But it's obviously a clearing of what needs to flow out of our mouth and needs to happen. Yeah, we don't have the words. So the last few lives that we did on here, if we're not mistaken, are relative to... connection to source energy. We started that off in the Joy to Coco because it was the depths within. And then we came on here to kind of connect in, because we do stuff through the live. We don't seem to be able to do stuff naturally through the videos and the setups to do with the memory cards and the storage. Like, for instance, when we were doing all that stuff earlier, we saved it all and thought we were doing really well with saving it, which is probably what has happened before. But then when it came to finding it, it's a different one of us that finds it, to saves it, and then we couldn't find it. So it takes us ages to find it. So we're constantly learning and finding the ways that work. But we're really chuffed. We've been so, since starting to do these lives, we did the box opening on Zanoni Snowflake, the first one. And then 1 week later, we thought we were going to do Shintos, but we did Joy to Coco. Then we did, another week later, we did the box opening, 1 week later, Joy to Coco, 1 week later, Shintos. That's 2 weeks. So 3 weeks later, we're here. So this is the fourth live. There's been 3 weeks. We're not sure what went on the first week. We can't quite remember. I'm not sure if that's, I think, yeah, we just don't, it's blank. But since last week, we've managed to start using the editing software on our computer. It was only about £74, the number of nature, that we purchased a year ago. And we've been wanting to do that for ages. So we're really chuffed we've started doing that, and started creating videos, the shorts from these lives that we're doing, it turns out. And they've been really quite interesting. I think we're just going to put it on like this and see what happens. This was just a last minute thing because we've got two necklaces up there. I think they got from some tribe somewhere. When we're traveling. So, we need to obviously do this to get the words flowing, because otherwise the words might not flow in this. So we've just been doing the editing, which has been going really well. We're really shocked. We managed to get up till today's done. The last one just went out at 5 o'clock, Sagittarius, which we haven't actually watched. And so that was three a day. And we got set times for them and everything. And we got 2 days ahead of ourselves. We have to start all over again tomorrow. But that's okay. And there's been, for us, there's always, this might be to do with the autism and different ones of us understanding of the energy, which was still putting it into words and collaborating it all. But there's always these patterns of behind the ways we do things. And that's been the case in these lives as well. And we're learning to simplify things down. So we've literally just got the Liffruma deck here, although we do have some Egyptian tarot and oracle, but they were there for another reason, because we were pulling out the Mat card. That's changed its direction, hasn't it? How did it, why did it do that? Did we knock it? We look forward to when we've got all the proper gear and got the setup easy and sorted. So yeah, Matt, Cosmic Justice. So we were listening to Heather Ensworth, and the other tables full up of cards out to do her meditation, but we never got the meditation done, because this was yesterday. We swapped all our moon cards around yesterday. We haven't done that for a week, and we hadn't done the 10-day thing for a week, for 10 days, actually. We missed one slot of that. We went from 2 to 4, missed out the threes. So we've learned the editing on software. We've been starting to do our daily Liffruma out on the cards again. So we're really getting into a flow and learning to balance and juggle. The kitchen had been a mess, but that was a mess before we started doing the lives. But we've actually managed to put all of the washing up. That was kind of, most of it had been first round washed. It just needs second round wash, because we haven't got the dishwasher stuff sorted. But we put it all in the bath. So most of that's all been washed up, and the kitchen's got like, keeps getting a bit more space. So we're balancing the spirituality and practicality. We still haven't been in the garden for ages, but there's also been lots of rain here, and that just seems to have gone wild. So, because we weren't going to go live until we got all the house kind of up to a certain level of standard, but that wasn't happening. So then it's like, well, we'll start starting the live journey. We weren't going to go live until we got all the and house kind of up to a certain level. We always get to this idea that we want something as a, like a clean slate to start with, but if we never really, I mean, the last time the house was really full on clean everywhere was mid-January. It's always a constant juggle, and then without the dishwasher it uses up so much energy. So if we don't have the energy all the time, or we're in pain, then you can't, you know, standing up and doing the dishes, a whole other story. And then the hot water, putting the thing on, we've got a smart meter, so putting the hot water on, you can see how much that uses up. So it's actually cheaper in the day to boil the kettle and do it during the day and boil the kettle than it is to put the hot water on at night. And now, and if you put it on for us, it'll be on then from like midnight to 7 in the morning, unless you remember to turn it off. So it only really needs to be on for 3-4 hours, not 7. So that kind of almost doubles the amount of money. So there's all the awareness coming into play, which is really good, because we're facing things rather than being in denial and going, I don't want to get a smart meter, because that'll make me aware of how much electricity I'm using. And it's that these things are all the things that matter. And so when we lived in a caravan, we lived in a field in a caravan where we had to carry a sack of, a sack of coal or a sack of wood or a water, like two mini fields, from the distance where the car was parked to the caravan. But this gives us a sense of appreciation, a gratitude, and an awareness of where the water comes from, where the wood comes from, that, you know, to actually, you can't just turn a switch and it comes on from somewhere. And these are all the different tools that we've used over our whole life to not take things for granted, to not get lazy, because we knew that sometimes we could be lazy, even though we could also do, but we didn't know about the DID then, and so we're understanding things a lot more better. And we've always been someone that's pushed ourselves too much rather than the other way around, with a body that's never really functioned properly, but we believe we can change all that. And so this is the Shinto yoga experience, and that's about, and it's with the Shinto self-empowerment, so it's about empowering oneself first, and then understanding that the yoga is the yokin, it's the union of the body, the mind, the soul, using the breath to do so. That's a very basic terminology, but you can have yoga of your hands, you can have yoga of sound, you've got yoga of your body. So there's the yoga of anything, really. And for us, it's about this subtle yoga, connecting to subtle energies, where if we're using up at least four times more energy than the average person, and that's if that's an elastanlos, if one's healthy, then we need to figure out ways where we put in minimum effort with most output. And so all of this is a continuation of self-transformative tools, finding the ways that can develop the willpower, the motivation, the drive to do things, but also taking things gently. But that it's the baby steps that matter, and creating balanced, firm, strong, flexible foundations. And so here's the diary, Jenny Florence's diaries that we've done for a while. 16 came up again, so we had in the post today 16p. 16 is the number of rebirth, it's the number of the tower. So we've been doing conscious managed towers in collaboration with consciousness, rather than the fourth tower, like what happened in the psych ward in 2020. 16 is also the mirror of 61, self-love. That came through the post today, and also came up somewhere else. Here, that's why. So, for instance, you can see the stickers in the book. If we flip back, it kind of changes. So you've got pink back there in January, you've got a bit of pink and yellow there. Got numbers 9, so this is our real food box delivery. Green, got number 11, green and blue, green, green. So it's always all this stuff is kind of like It's symbolic support. It's the symbology. It's the colours and the patterns and the numbers, and everything that lines up around us. But what's the symbolism in that? What's the connection? But not to always be consciously looking for it. Actually, to surrender the need to consciously know and understand, and then the knowing and the understand flows in. So. Yeah, blue and green, that's a not a number one. And all the numbers on it, you've got like 10, 4 here, and then you've got the root number down here. So you have had the Yoda yellows then back in April, blues and greens. These were hearts that suddenly appeared outside. There were 5, blue and green, blue. But lately it's been basically a lot of pink, we remember. Pink, pink, bit of green. Pink, and then yellow came in today, and it was 4097. So for us, we're at 97, adds up to 16. That's like the check number. And yellow came in today. Today on the daily Liffruma was is about the completion, and the physical reality is the new beginning. And then that's 98 and 99. 99 is the number of compassion. 4 is the number that was really congested and damaged within us, because we were age 4 when our mum committed suicide, when the incest sexual abuse happened from 4 to 5, and then 15. 15 can be second tier four and contraction. But the four frequency's been healed. Four is also relative to house four in the collective astrology chart, which is Cancer, because Cancer is the fourth house. And it's the Cancer new moon that's coming up. And so when we came out of the psych ward, and the psych ward was a real tower moment, there was even outside the window, there's this container unit with a polar bear on it. And some scaffolding to the right, a scaffolding a scaffolding tower. And above that was the full moon. And it was the Leo full moon, which is our rising, our ascendant, which is also our north node. So our rising or ascendant is 29 degrees 22, and a north node is 29 degrees 28. It was house number 28 we picked up outside of. It's adding up to 10. We were in room number 10 in psych ward. And when we started our meditation on the external reality through the portal of the World Wide Web in a group, sound healing group meditation, that was on the 10th of January 2020. So that's 11/22, your double numbers. And so when we came out of the psych ward, we were put into survival, and we discovered us working together. And the first thing then was the double Cancer new moon in June and July. We're getting a bit chilly now because the windows are open, but it's good that they're open. And we've got the cardigan here. So we noticed before, we'd spent ages getting the alignment of this camera, which is normally more important to us. And then something to do with the colours, the hearts and the name were yellow. And so it's more important for us to take the camera down and change that back than it was with the alignment. And that's really quite unusual. And so we did this thing when we were with Lunar Living, and it was meant to be for like 6 months, but this was in 2020.
And so we did this thing when we were with Lunar Living.
And it would have been, it would have been the Cancer new moon in 2020. So we're 3 years later. So that's six times as long to what it was kind of. It was meant for like a 3 months, a season, or half a year, 3 to 6 months. But for us, it was like six to 12 times longer. And it was three actions we will take during waxing moon to help take us closer to our vision are: one, morning; two, daily; three, evening; self-care and nurturing moon zodiac circular system routine. So that's what we've been doing, but it's all been surrendered to the subconscious and the superconscious. And so we've done that because we couldn't do it from our conscious mind, but we've learned a lot of stuff in our conscious minds between us all over the decades since we were 18, 25 years ago. That number's coming up a lot as well, or 2052. And yes, circular system routine it's the internal, the feminine.
Yes, circular system routine.
So three things we commit to doing over the next 3 months before autumn equinox. So there we go, it's 3 months, not 6 years. So this is taking us 12 times longer. Establish healthy boundaries and balance in all our bodies. Need nurturing house, garden, self-care, which we are doing lots better at. And on this side, you do actually have, I don't know, one of our things of color coordinating things, and green, Shinto's personal relationships, collective, laminating book first. I don't know, there's loads of different things trying to organize and sort it out. But two, this Cancer solstice retreat weekend all again on next Cancer new moon, Friday the 17th of July. We did do that. Monday the 20th evening is new moon. 3, establish and embed self-care, nurturing, clear, honest, healthy, impeccable internal self-dialogue and communication with all of us. So we have, but it's not in the logical format of communication of words and structuring like this. So although we've managed a lot of these things, and although they're still not our new, consistent, habitual, automatic patterning, we're still in the process of doing it. We are in this, it's happening, but there's still a bit of to and froing and ebbing and flowing, ebbing and flowing. But this is what happens when one is reprogramming and setting a new program. It takes time, especially when there's lots of you that you've got to do from different ages, different sexes, different personalities that are on completely opposite ends of the spectrum. I'm sure anyone that's got kids, one kid is completely, and one kid's completely different from the other, the same parenting's not going to, style's not going to work. And so for us, it really is just frequency, humming, sounding, buzzing, but always connecting into the heart and knowing what we want. So our vision for the future is more of like, well, we want to feel this way. We want to be able to experience certain things. And yes, we want that, that, and that, and that. But how it comes, where it comes, what it looks like, we don't know, as long as it's got that core, fundamental, foundational feeling of unconditional love and compassion and patience and gentleness and all of those things. And it involves nature and it involves empowerment and play and creativity and lots of things. So we were very thorough. Three ways we, and we've been doing this for like, again, since we moved into, since we built our van and moved into our van in 2000, bought it in 2010, 2011. Three ways we will step forwards into who we are here to be. Knowing, accepting the present moment is most important, and dancing with it best we can, welcoming, nurturing, accepting, love, oh, accepting lower vibrations when they happen. Continue to be open, and then two, continue to be open and honest with all of us and master co-consciousness. 3, master control over our body and full connection of our heart. Then green, our intention for second half of 2020 to just be and fully learn and master self-care and nurturing. And I feel that we have done that from an energetic perspective, if not having fully embedded that into the physical habitual patterning and routine. But we are seeing tangible evidence of it, which is great. I mean, we're up here doing these videos, doing the editing on the phone, doing the editing on this, keeping to it. Now, how long we can do that for, well, time will tell, because the patterning we've done at the moment isn't sustainable. But we have started cleaning the house and balancing everything else out. And we know it's not sustainable, but when one starts learning something new and doing something new, it does take a bit more time until a flow, until the initial inertia has stopped and a flow and a momentum continues. So that's what we're just hoping will happen, is that the flow and momentum will continue. We started walking backwards again. Was that last night or this morning? I think that might have been this morning. That was this morning. The first time this morning that gone out the window because of pain. And then it went out the window because we're too tired, because the editing that we've done, we've been doing like anywhere from like 10 to 14 hour days with like food breaks and rest breaks when we need it. But that's been our main focus, is the editing, going back to that. And we needed to get into the garden, but haven't done that because of the rain. But then there are things we could have done in the garden with the rain. But this is what it's like with the dissociation, with the personalities, with it's finding, making friends with us all and finding the ways that to get us back into it. So we ordered Amanda Ellis's Christ Consciousness deck, and then I didn't realize it was Prime Day and there was discounts on, so then we ordered this one as well. I think one of the titles of our videos was the Queen of Cups Merkaba, something about the Queen of Cups Merkaba. This one had been, has been squashed and split, and it's a Metatron, and the Metatron is, it's Archangel Metatron, but that is, he's part of the Merkaba frequencies. But humans like to put narratives and stories and words that make sense, so we put people to these energetics and frequencies. these sacred geometry frequencies, because that's a narrative and stuff that we're familiar with as humans. But we say we're, but speaking from as humans, for us, we're not familiar with those words and those narratives as such, the majority of us, but some of us are. And so what with the book that we're reading, Fairy Tale, I Scry with Steph, and then the tarot readers that we watch, the connections that are all like overlapping between certain words and colours and titles and themes are all coming together, that all then relate into our body or memories. So I think Graveyards, Good Kisser from the I Scry with Steph, today with Cindy and Wakening Spirit, she was talking about a wedding away and Newfoundland. So our first kiss was in a graveyard opposite the house that we went out to for our family to be the Coleman representative of our family, and we were 13. So our first kiss was in a graveyard in Newfoundland at a wedding away. So it's all these little bits that kind of come in from all over the place that then trigger the traumas and the memory in us to open up channels and rewire and put it all together again. It was with an 18-year-old as well, so it's our first kiss, but it was a horrible memory with other things. We went out with a 30-year-old when we were 15. There's always quite not nice, quite horrible frequencies attached to relationships and loving relationships, but then that's understandable because of the incest sexual abuse at 4 and then 15. And so we're understanding full spectrums of diversity, but because our conscious minds and lots of us can handle it, it's been done in a real creative abstract way, but it couldn't be done in a too creative abstract way because we're so logical and mathematical and linear. So it's a logical abstract way, and now I feel we're bringing that logical abstract into the abstract logic. So logic abstract, logical abstract, which is the logical part of the abstract, so it's a bit closer, and then the abstract logical, so you've got, it's the abstract part of the logical, and so they're closer on the hemispheres for bridging the brain connections. It's these, that's the limited words that we've got to be able to put with it. And then with all our healing and all of our therapies, so this is the all 12 signs plus Ophiuchus. For us, Ophiuchus is the 13th sign, the serpent bearer, the great healer. For us, that connects into the Kundalini energies of the Ida and Pingala crossing over, like the two snakes that cross over at the intersection being the Sushumna, the central channel, the spinal column, the spine, the masculine energies. Well, all energies do it, but energy that comes in and gets filtered through and goes directly out, and we call it the masculine energies because we relate it to 11, which is the central channel, the Sushumna, whereas the feminine energies, and plus mask is like the black absorbs energies, and so you get a lot of bachelors that just have black in their house, and it's because black holds all the colors, it's to gain, it's absorbing more colors to gain more information. White reflects all the colors. So this figure of eight pattern going around the body is the central channels are your collarbones to your sit bones, and then there's two of them with the figure eight pattern that goes round on each of the planes. And so the Ida and Pingala is the masculine energies and the feminine energies crossing over at the intersection of the Sushumna. And so this comes into the tuning forks that went into play. It was the D sharp, which is the anchoring tuning fork frequency. Was it 300 hertz? I can't remember now. That we're using to connect them in. See, D sharp, you've got your C, which is your root chakra, your D, and these are the white keys, C, D, E, so that would be red, orange, yellow. Red, C, E, yellow, E is a sound one makes for the energies to reach up here. So this is bringing in our sound healing now as well, but it's just we're not able to get all the words out, we feel, in such a coherent way. It's just snippets here and there. And when we watch and listen to ourselves back, so there's words missing or words that aren't quite added in, but it will all come together. There's going to be some kind of mind-blowing narrative and story that comes together from all the bits. So E is what gets the energy up to the brain. You see the root chakra, red. Your E, your solar plexus chakra, the empowerment. Your root chakra is and then you've got orange in the middle, which is your D. So your D, C sharp connects your red and your orange, and your D sharp connects your orange and your yellow. Your yellow being the rib cage, where the diaphragm is, that controls the fire in the body. And for our fire to work and burn, it needs the breath, it needs the air. To get a fire to really burn, you need to have the dry wood, the cured wood, the seasoned wood, but you also need the air and how that air is coming in, the force, the direction. So this brings in the elemental forces and the directional forces, which are all the cards we have on the table over there. Not all of them, we've got more than that. I mean, there's ones of us that wanted to take photos so we could put it into here and present the photos, but that's all to do with the meditation. It's got all the cards from the astro codes for the nodal transits that come into play. So the energies that we're doing now, putting through this, the words being the least important, it's part of our manifestation process, communicating to spirit. And it's like, whoa, how come we suddenly couldn't do anything for all this time and wanted to do certain things, and then suddenly it's all go, go, go and burning? And that's because of the astrological, it's the planetary energies, the cosmic energies and the Earth's planetary energies. And so the nodal shift that's taking, we grew up, we're a quadruple Aquarius, we're air, but we grew up in a household, okay, so not... Because there was it, mum died at 85 is when he remarried, 88 is when he split up. So in 88, when we were 8, we moved into house number 88. So all these numbers become really symbolic. When we moved into house number 88, that's pretty much when he got together with our now stepmom, but they didn't live together and they didn't get married until we were like 18. And we were kind of left, but that it was a, she was a Aries, her son was Cancer, our father's Capricorn and our brother's Libra. And so that is the global axes, and that those are the energetics that with our DID, those are the energetics that we kind of mirrored in lots of ways. We don't have any Cancer in our chart. Our Cancer is in house 11. House 11 is the collective house of Aquarius. And we talk about triangulation a lot. So the way we do things is very different to the set paths and the set ways when you look into the different types of astrology or all the different anything, even the Iyengar yoga. We do it their way, but it never quite works for us. I mean, if what's working for us in the body now is we're doing all the things that you get told not to do in Iyengar yoga with the yoga teacher training, but it's because we're having to unwind the patterning that we did on top of the abstract creative patterning that our body did as a genius coping mechanism of the early childhood trauma, and the DID and the autism, because we believe autism is the future brain. We believe autism, and this is going back into the two dominant sensory systems at the moment, for we're not sure how big a collective, but we think on a big collective of humanity, is the visual sense of color, like color therapy. It doesn't matter if it's color therapy or not, people get drawn to wanting to wear a certain color nail varnish, a certain color lipstick, certain color clothes. People get drawn to certain smells and perfumes. So it doesn't matter if you're in the mainstream fashion or if you're in an alternative fashion or what have you, there's still these fundamental frequencies that will incorporate the majority of people, even down to people that can't smell. Now in our conscious mind awareness now, there's two people that we, one from the past and one from our present, that we know of whose sense of smell didn't work. The one in the past was from a head injury of a car boot hitting down on a head and causing the neurological pathways not to function on the nervous system between the olfactory pathways and the brain, wherever that is. And the one that we know currently now is a child. And we have our own belief systems around that, but it's belief systems based from our experiences of what's gone on. And we believe that with the modern brain will, let's go back a bit. As we grow up, you have the initial regenerative processes of a child growing up, growing an optimum body from the organs, growing outwards, and subconscious programming happens when you're a child. The first main stage is 0 to 7. These are from different philosophies. There's never one set way because we're in an infinite multiverse. And then you get more layers put on top, so that the deepest subconscious is in the deepest core. And when you put that into a muscular skeletal terminology, the first muscles to wake up is your hip flexors as a baby, when a baby sits up. And there's some schools of thought that says all fear and trauma and anxiety are stored in your psoas muscle, your psoas major and your psoas minor, ilias, psoas, ilias major or something. It takes 4 times more energy around that to use your thumb than it does your psoas. Because your psoas muscle is an involuntary muscle. It's an automatic muscle rather than a voluntary muscle like your thumb. So this comes with the programming of the muscles, the programming of our experiences from childhood to then getting suppressed because we live our life out and do our everyday things and get a bit domesticated and conditioned by society and family and teachers. And then patterns and cycles of the energetic patterns and cycles in the body don't have certain ways, places or ways to go because of either one's current life traumas or because of generational trauma that's in the family lineage that's encoded into our genetic blueprint, or because of being an empath or a highly sensitive person, and we absorb the frequencies from the land around us. And if there's we were just gonna talk about rocks and crystals and the slower vibration and the information that's held. So the denser an object, the slower the vibration. The slower the vibration, the more memory, the more information. And we live in an area which has a lot of quartz crystal, which then amplifies the information. So we've talked about a lot of information there. We've got sidetracked. We've obviously got into the FLOMO state. We feel, because of you guys, my lovelies, that we're a body intuitive. And we understand the energetic patterning. Different ones of us understand it from different conceptualizations and different bodies because of the DID. And there's a lot of personalities that were separated from the body to be able to cope with the experiences when we're younger. There's the those ones, I think, that hadn't even got a chance to be birthed into the body. So what does it mean to be birthed in the body? We're talking about the energetic frequencies. So Kundalini rising. Kundalini is a coiled up spiral of energy in one sacrum. If you look at a fetus in the womb, it's curved up into almost that like starting Fibonacci spiral. As one grows, it develops one's posture, and the potential can be reached in the postural body if there is postural alignment. And then certain experiences happen throughout life. And then when people get into like their 40s, the midlife crisis can kind of happen. And that's when there's a, like an external tarot moment that will be a catalyst to open up extra channels in the body for a chance to have more of the rainbow spiral energetics that we feel are outside of us, because initially we feel like we just are a physical body, unless we have grown up with people that understand the etherical world, esoterica, the astral plane, dreams, shamanism, 29 degrees of each sign being apparently the shamanic degree we learned off Heather Ensworth yesterday on that video.
29 degrees of each sign.
So we've got these headphones here. We're just going to try and muffle them because.
So
auditory, we're very highly attuned auditory wise. So when trauma happens, it cuts off sensory systems. We also think a gift of autism is to cut off certain sensory systems so that as a collective, the sensory systems that are getting overdeveloped in a collective, because energy tends to go from one extreme to another, you either want to not be like your parents but and end up completely opposite or exactly the same. It's quite challenging to find the middle ground, to find that minimum oscillation. So we're just actually going to get into the cards because we're starting to struggle with the words. But how we did the cards last time, we really loved, because at the end that's why we went on to the Ophiuchus being the Kundalini rising and the energy. So that's why we went all through there. And when we do these sidetracks to go through all there, it's because we're so present, because everything we talk about is actually happening in that immediate, in the dumbo day nana. We just had our parasympathetic nerve system kicking again, which is really good. Yeah, your sympathetic, like fight flight, the automatic, the instinctual, and the parasympathetic, the rest and digest, which we also relate and connect to the vagus nerve, the left vagus nerve being the rest and digest, and the right ones being the fight flight. But there's different layers. You've got your parasympathetic, you've got sympathetic, and then you've got your autonomic nervous system. So yeah, and I know there's ones of us that have learned lots of this before, we've got to get back into it. But we do on the three axes, we do the cardinal, the mutable, the fixed, and then there'll be the Ophiuchus. Although last week, that would explain it though. Last week, we didn't consciously do Ophiuchus, but there was a card that came out at the beginning, which between us all, but not in a conscious awareness, was called the bonus card. But then on watching it back, it was like, that's Ophiuchus, and that came out at the start. And so it all made sense. But of course, when we're in Shinto self-empowerment energetics, we're in the past energetics, and Ophiuchus doesn't exist for them because they didn't know about it. And so we did the card axes. We got very much more into our flow, our way of things. And so for the younger ones that don't speak, for them, it's about aligning up the patterns. But the younger ones are black and white. They're not colour. And so they will have colours that completely don't go together, but they'll be looking at it in black and white and grey and putting the patterns together. But for us to say this now, it confuses us because we don't see that. It's us playing detective on ourselves and witnessing ourselves and questioning ourselves in now a compassionate, gentle way. Whereas before, there'd be the other ones in between that's like, why are we doing that? We don't need to do that. Oh, we've done that already. Blah, blah, blah. But they're the ones in between that. I don't even know if in between, in between the liminal state, they're in between the superficial muscles and the deep core muscles being the organs. Okay, there's a couple of liminal spaces. There's the liminal space between the deep tissue muscles and the superficial muscles, but then you've got the liminal space between the organs and that muscle group that we just talked about. And when one's in the liminal space, that's where they chaotic organization of the patterning of the body can be.
And when one,
and this is where one might actually eat really healthily and do bits of movement but not seem to shift any weight, and we think that's part of the restructuring and the realignment of the body, because the body, to put it into gardening speak, from our experiencing and observation and witnessing of our garden and growth through tangible first-hand experience, because that's how we learn. We're kinesthetic learner, the majority of us, and we don't remember things, we use our memory. We don't remember things and how we interpret conventional memory to be. We have to understand how something functions, and we work it out. So with the patch wisdom wheel, with all the tarot, so we've started going from the inside out, from the center out of the patch tarot. We used to get really confused before, because sometimes we'd get it right and sometimes we wouldn't get it right, and it's like, well, what's going on? We thought we'd figured out the pattern, but it's because we will shift, but we don't necessarily know when we shift, because we've had this our whole life but haven't known about it. And so these patterns and these formulas that we have will work if we're in those altars, but if we then switch altars and turn backwards or inside out, then that formula, that pattern won't work, because it then needs to be back to front or upside down or inside out to work. And so we're working this out, because last time what seemed to come out was the royals around the outside. And so you'd get a lot of people say, oh, the Queen of Cups is Cancer. Well, for us, not meaning to be pedantic, but for us, it's like, well, it's only 2/3 Cancer. Queen of Cups is 2/3 Cancer. And this will be really interesting to see if we get it right. And the sign before, but we're not even going to go there because we can't. And it's going to do something crazy. But like, we know that we know now that the queens are cardinals, the knights are fixed, the kings are mutable. We know now that there's only the Queen, for instance, even though she's cardinal, the cardinal astro signs, she's 2/3 cardinal and 1/3 previous sign. The next sign is knight, the previous sign would be king. King's immutable. So I think the queens are 2/3 cardinal, 1/3 mutable, but we can't quite tell you, and we haven't got a patch wisdom wheel here to look at it. So, but each of the astro signs, your cardinals, like the global axes of Libra and Aries, that's going to happen on the 17th of July with the Cancer new moon, is your 2, 3, 4s, because in the middle you have your aces and you have your pages. You have your aces, your baby energy, Christ consciousness, which is why we talked about that Archangel Metatron deck, actually, because that is the pyramid, the four based pyramid, your four based pyramid. So it's your square on the bottom, but it goes up to, there's a tetrahedron, I think. There's a shungite. We have these on our laptop to stop the MS, and that shungite as well. And so you'd get your two pyramids. Get the camera right here. And you'd twist them round, and they would slot into each other so that the square bit would come down and go up, and then that's your star tetrahedron. And so your babies is your Christ consciousness energy, your pure unconditional love. And you need to be dependent on someone else to live and grow. And your energy, the center, the core of your energetics, is then learning from monkey see, monkey do, not monkey say. It's like, get parents telling children to do whatever, but it's like, that isn't going to work. It's what you're doing. And whatever, you know, our kids, when they bug the hell out of us, it's because they're reflecting to us the parts that we're in denial about. But then when we get into the page energies, that's like your teenage years, and that's when there's a sense of identity, where you're starting to figure out your own identity. And this is where I think, I'm not sure which live, I think this might have been Joy to Coco, that we started figuring out we were in the pages energies. And actually that's interesting, because Matt, the cosmic justice that came into Heather Ensworth's reading for the meditation, And Eve's on her Egyptian theme again as well. And there's more Egyptian stuff coming up. And in our I Scry with Steph, hieroglyphs and Egyptian stuff. And I'm not sure if it's Anunnaki, but some other stuff kind of came up with her. And from our GCSE artwork, we have a lot of Egyptian stuff in that as well. There's a lot of Egyptian stuff and sacred geometry stuff as well. So that all the stuff that we're kind of revisiting now is all stuff that we've done before, not that we really kind of consciously remember. And so when we got this Egyptian tarot out, which we absolutely love because it's got all kinds of narrative, it's a different type of Egyptian one that Eve from Everlong Mystic follows, I think, because certain dates on the astrology sign don't add up, but it gives you a whole kind of introduction and a timeline here going back to the first tarot that came out. And if you look it up for the Rider Waite, and our connections with the tarot, the Rider-Waite tarot, I mean, Pamela Coleman Smith, Coleman was our last name on our birth given name, although hers doesn't have an E and ours did have an E. She lived down in Cornwall near St. Just, which is like 10, which is about 20, 30 miles away from where we are now. Her, was it her birthday or her death? I think her birthday was on the 16th of February, which is the day after ours. So there's so many connections to all of this stuff. So 1442, the acquisition of triumph cards for the knights is documented in the Registro dei Mandati of the Est Duchy. This is the first known document about the Lodus Triumphorum, which would become famous over the subsequent centuries as the game of tarot cards. During the 15th century, the Ludus Triumphorum became one of the most widespread card games in the courts of northern Italy. What remains of the 30 or so illuminated packs conserved in public and private collections in Europe and the United States undoubtedly refers to the Visconti Sforza family of Milan and the Est family of Ferrara. Our stepmoms. First marriage's name was Milan. So our stepbrother's last name is Milan. We've been to Milan in North Italy. So for us, it's like in here in England, you have mallets, mallet, word association. For us, it's frequency association. So in I Scry with Steph, she said Beetlejuice, the film Beetlejuice. We're like, oh, that's filmed here. That was filmed here. But we got confused because it was Blue Juice that was filmed here. But Beetle and Blue, they both have a B, they both have L, they both have an E.
Is that you then?
No, Worm, you don't live here. So it's about the colours, the patterns, the numbers, the smells and the frequencies that overlap them. So Cindy had a real nasty bruise on her left side, which she barred into some handlebars. For us, our congestion and our knots that are really tight are in our deep left-hand side, and we can feel it. Like a lot of people, when they do yoga and become yoga teachers and really have a long practice of yoga, over like the years getting tapped into their body, they'll start being able to feel their kidneys move or their adrenals move above their kidneys or these deep organs. They can actually, when you go into yoga, it'll be like, bring your kidneys towards your spine and up. For us, we never really got any of that because, but then we started getting all this other stuff. We could feel the nerves. We could feel the nervous system. We could feel the sheath of the nerves. And then with the DID and as things went on, it became clearer because different personalities, which are the body speaking to us, hold different networks. So there might be five or six personality teams that have the heart, and then those teams will be split up so that one of those teams will be functioning, and then will function different parts of the body. So of course we never felt a full organ because our organs aren't in its full optimum resonant frequency functioning as one whole. They're functioning as multiple wholes within the one. So you don't feel the one kidney, you'll feel parts of the kidney, but then feeling part of the patterning of the kidney, it's not really very easy to decipher that that's the kidney. And so that's with the DID and the way things have kind of gone energetically. So we feel the energy in our body very acutely. And when we connect into people, what through the YouTube, it's happening imminently between words that we're writing and listening to what they're saying, and watching a tarot reader scratch their forearm, or oh, we can't put it into words yet, it's so frustrating. We will get there. So where's the, we just want to show, because we did, where's the, here it is. Arthur Edward Waite, head of one of the factions of the Golden Dawn, published the pictorial key to the tarot, dedicated to tarot mysticism and divination, and illustrated with figures from a splendid pack in a pre-Raphaelite style painted by a disciple of the Golden Dawn, Pamela Colden Smith. We believe, our listeners as well, help spirits cross over. We feel, the ones of us talking now feel completely crazy saying this because we're disconnected to it, but there's videos of it live. They help spirits cross over, especially spirits that have drowned, connected to the sea or the ocean. So if they do that, I suppose there's other ones of us connected to it on other levels. So how other people say they'll connect into spirits and entities, and how we're always saying that it doesn't work like that for us. We are really doing the same thing as them. We just experience it as something different and call it as something different because of our understanding and connection of words, which generally seems to be very different to the majority because we've had to figure out our own way. But that's in 1910. Which is an 11 frequency, the vibration of Zanoni Snowflake. So 1910, from 1442, what is, I say 1410 to 1910, that's 500 years, minus 32, which is the age our mum drowned. So that's 32 years extra. So if you, okay, let's go up to 1510. So that's 400 years plus 58 plus 10, 468 years, 468, you've got your 2 code there going on. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. It's 15, that's the 15th section in the book. So it's really interesting that you hear that the Rider Waite is the traditional tarot, because for us it's the 15th deck, it's in the second tier. You've got 0 to 9 and then 10 to 19, it's in the second tier, not the first tier. So I don't know where we're going with this. I think what we're doing with this is that there is no factual truth. Everything that we feel is factual truth as human beings was all recorded by, started by one person that wrote something down that was very good at expressing in written format or academic format, because that's the way our society's really developed, their subjective experience into an objective experience. And when enough people can do that and enough objective experiences align, then we decided to call that fact. But for us, that feels like a really kind of, we're speaking in energetics now, but it does kind of entail that most of the people that did this to start out with were males, because women weren't allowed to learn or educate themselves. But it's a very masculine energy in a very masculine body, and it's limited because the masculine energy is about the part, the feminine energy is about the whole. And it's not that it's wrong or right or good or bad, that's duality reality. It's just how evolution's danced, but evolution's changing. And this is, we have to keep saying this and we have to keep repeating this. Well, we don't have to, but we obviously feel we do. The repetition helps the reprogramming. When we do it on the different channels, we're doing it in the different energetic states, it becomes more of an embedded habitual pattern, more of a new frequency, that what we're doing is following our own intuitive guidance, our own intuitive ways. And with everything that's going on and all the synchronicities and alignment in the numbers, and then doing these daily Liffrumas, and then watching other people and that seeing those same energetic frequencies come through, and then just being gobsmacked, is actually, well, why are you gobsmacked? Everyone's told you you're psychic. Your whole life between your different personas and with different people, this is what it's been about. It's just before we've always put our energy in to the one person. We've not put it into the collective, which makes complete sense, because if we had put it into the collective, we would have gone crazy because there's so many in here already. We didn't have our own sense of one identity. We've got our own senses of many identities, many charisma, many characters with charismas, but we're not making it up. It's the difference of acting is it's a conscious intention. With DID, they're characters and it's subconscious and it's programmed into the deeper levels inside, into the connective tissue, the fascia, the matrix of the body. And so the other card related to Matt was the Knave of Swords, the Page of Swords. Now, the Page of Swords and the Ace of Swords is your winter energies. And we like the Patch Wisdom Wheel. It works really well for our kids. And although we don't agree with some of the stuff that Jordan River says, we do know that he's put in a hell of a lot of effort. And he does his research, and his research is also diverse like us. And the Knight of Swords, the Knights, so what was coming, so this is to do with, I suppose, you have your elemental forces, and it's never about just looking at one. We tend to look at an astrology chart, and to start with, when one's starting out, as a beginner, they just look at one, because otherwise, I mean, Pam Gregory was saying about the, like, I don't know if it's just 3,000, just on a certain layer, before you really get into the depths and dimensions and the realities, permutations of different things and energetic patterning. So just because chaos and shit hit the fan the last time that this nodal shift happened doesn't mean it's going to happen again, because you've got so many more ingredients. It's kind of like, rather than following a recipe to a cake, you might add more eggs one time and less sugar. You might add more flour and less butter. It's all going to change how the cake and ends up coming out, whether it's light and airy, whether it's dense, whether it even sticks together in the first place, whether it tastes good, whether it tastes like cake and it's nice and sweet, or whether it starts tasting like an eggy omelet thingy. And what works for one doesn't necessarily work for another. And so for us, the most important thing is not to dictate to others how to do something. It's about facilitating them to find their own way and trust their own way, even if it's even if there's no one else out there that seems to have that way. And so the Knights are your directional movements, and we're really studying, because we've got a picture we did when we were 16, which has kind of got like, it's not the Dalai Lama, it's the Mama. No, it's not the Dalai Lama. Dali. Is it Dali? Did Dali do all your mounted clocks? And the layers of colours at the top and the bottom. We've got one like that anyway. And when we first understood about the psychology of art, before we really understood that actually the strength of one's environment, and how just like we're constantly projecting out there, and how what we say, what we do, how we say it, how we decorate our house, how we decorate ourselves, what car we want to buy. And there's another thing, actually, Cindy was talking about her car in her analogy today in the Pisces reading, and was talking about some black shiny Maserati or something, and then went into a Volkswagen Beetle. So it's just like, these we don't do it justice. So yeah, the energy, it's like we couldn't learn about ourselves from the inside. We've learned ourselves about ourselves from the outside in, hence why we needed to be anchored in one spot, not leaving that spot, because this is the portal. All those cards we have on the table is the portal. Our cards are portals. Our cards and our books are our therapists. When we got cards going on and other people, readers, bring those cards up, there's a portal frequency connection going on there, along with the numbers and other things. So we will get really much better at describing this, probably through the story. Zendaya, is that you? Yeah, okay, sweetheart, hold on. We're just going to let in Zen, bear with us. We didn't put on our ankle things today, did we? Or our knee things. We
can put on our ankle one.
Hey, darling. Sorry, sweetheart. The energy's strong, isn't it?
Oh, we're definitely connecting on the energy. We can feel, no, sorry, you don't want to be touched, I know.
We're
sparking when we touch our cat.
Definitely.
We used to work in Woolworths and we used to work in the entertainment section with all the CDs, and because of the material of the clothes and working with the plastic, we'd give change back to people and create sparks between our fingers and their fingers. It reminds us of that film on Amazon with the women that develop the thing in their collarbone and can like spark their fingers, because we've actually had that. You've got your biscuits there. You'll be okay with your biscuits for a little while, sweetheart, yeah? We'll get the meat in a minute for you. So when we were studying the cards, the Knight of Wands was rearing. So what one of us said was like revving the engine of a car. So the momentum's not happening, but you're about to start that race. You're in Formula One. You're about to go into the Ace of Swords. But if you look at the horse in the Ace of Swords, there's the point, the pinpointed force, directional pinpointed energy, focused energy, and the sword. It's all going in one direction. And so the momentum's there, it's going. But in the Knight of Wands, the horse is rearing, the head's down, and it's the difference of revving the car, but you haven't taken your foot off the throttle. Well, that's if you drive a manual. We don't know the explanation for an automatic. They're quite different, aren't they? We have done it before in Australia, but we're not in those energies now. And so the Knight of Cups is just like a gentle little trot. We used to ride a horse a lot as well. And see, tomorrow we'll play theta. And that's where we twisted all three planes on our sacrum. So because we're talking about this, because we're talking about this in the body, this is going to be sorting itself out in our body, in the sacrum too. And the Knight of Pentacles is just a static, standing there pose, a still pose. And in our daily Liffruma card today, the card was number 45. 45 adds up to 9. It's nines the, we see 9 as completion in the physical, tangible reality. I've got a sharp pain. But we see 10 as karmic completion in the unseen energetics. So 9 is the ending, 10 is the ending and the beginning together. But for us, the ending is the beginning, because you've always got an overlap on the spectrum. And with editing, for us, learning the editing and doing these lives and just doing it this way is because that's the only way we seem to be able to, how we seem to be able to do it. And we're all about, come on, bye, Nana. Yeah. I scribe Steph said how the cards were coming out really efficiently, and we are training ourselves to be really efficient from a fundamental energy, unseen energetic frequency level, because we use up so much energy that we don't have anyway, and we're all about the regeneration, so we have to be efficient. So yeah, so we're just going to read the Knight of Swords. Matt scribe. And we've been talking about twirling fingers and twiddling fingers. And we've gone from a collective in humanity that has used their hands to write into the current generation, where it wouldn't surprise us if there were kids that had just did everything on a laptop and didn't pick up a pen and couldn't write. So that's the extreme oscillation from one end of the pendulum to the other. Whereas for us, it's about being able to do it all, being able to do it both. A man is writing on a tablet. There is a sword above him, the symbol of Maat, goddess of justice. Positive, lawyer, spy, agent at work, surprising news, ciphered messages, secrecy, vigilance. Negative, unpreparedness, improvidence. Is that like improvisation? It's got definitely got a root word to it, hasn't it? But sounds different. swindler, occult enemy, and black magic. So, yeah, there's that read out. I don't know if that's going to come into play later, but that's coming into play now. Tito Momo, the banana. Okay, so that's why we didn't do the meditation yesterday. That's come into play now because Heather's put Ma'at up as the symbol on her thumbnail. So she's already had her pinpointed. Tito Momo! Yeah, okay. She's already had her pinpointed, focused Knight of Swords directional energy into focusing that attention of her meditation through the World Wide Web by putting her video out there. But not just by putting a video out there, she's actually got the visual sensory system on the thumbnail. She's got her collective of followings. We do it backwards. We don't really have a collective of a following as such. So rather than us going out on the funnel and us being at the pointed and having a collection of people following us, we follow a lot of people differently and diversely from the different sensory systems. So there'll be all, it's string theory, it's quantum entanglement. There'll be those rainbow energetic threads that we're tapping into all these different people from different collectives, be it your, yeah, you know, we watch a lot of, be it your van people, dwellers, because all the stuff that's, a lot of stuff that's happening now, we've done all this in our past life, in our past lives of this life. Yeah, it's hard to describe. So yeah, basically this, what we're coming out with now is snippets of our little ones doing the process that they need to do from their child. So what do they call us? A divine feminine child adult genius. So from the divine feminine child genius that they are, they've got all these little things that they do to connect into the energetics. The domesticated, conditioned adults, ones of us, are a lot more accepting to let them do it, because the more we've witnessed it and the more we've made friends with the really challenging ones, the more everything is just beautifully connecting and beautifully flowing. At the end of the day, what we aim for, for us, because for us it's always been about the other, and for nature, they're deeply connected to Mother Earth. I mean, people have said to us, this one a cousin said to us, it sounds like we're speaking from Mother Earth's womb. When we got let out of the psych ward, it was by a psychiatrist. When you're going to listen to someone, you sit down, you listen to them. Listen is an anagram of silent. So we have to make our internal subjective reality silent and put our energy into them. And for us, we'd be really good at that. And then when they're speaking to us, you listen, but you don't, and then you speak back to them to say, you know, you don't parrot back to them the words they used. You sit there and go, I heard you say this. Is that correct? Is that what's going on, or have I misinterpreted it? But that's just from a simple level, from the word, academic word communication body. For us, we get most of our communication from the energy, from the body. I mean, the memories that are coming back to us are from people that we knew for glimpses of time, from a bar in Australia when we worked in it, and suddenly their sacrum will come into our mind. Suddenly their big beer stomach will come into their mind. Suddenly their collarbone will come into our mind, and there'll be these connections energetically on a body communicative level. And so if you're going to be a really good listener, it'll be, okay, so I heard you say this, and you'll repeat back to them words that they didn't use to show that you're really understanding them from the vocal word communicative way. But it goes, but I feel this, because this is where we'll end up getting discrepancies that don't reconcile from someone when their energy and their body is telling you one thing, but their words are telling you something else. And it's really funny, because no wonder our superficial muscles and our outer body told such a lie to what was going on inside, and others wouldn't be able to read that. It would be a blank wall. But that was the strength of our weaving, our sewing, our protective shield around our whole body, because that, well, that's how we had to grow up with it. But we, from both ways, from inside out and outside in. So, oh, it is then. So we're going to do the cards, and we're going to do Ophiuchus first. And Ophiuchus is the high priestess. This is what's coming out in the moment, and we'll get ones of us watching it back and going, what do you mean by that? It's not that, it's this. But we have to do it because this is the only way we're going to get it out of the words. Ophiuchus is the high priestess. We see the high priestess as the divine feminine, the unseen energetics of the whole, which we haven't been able to put a number to it. We see the divine masculine as the hierophant, number five, change that brings freedom, as the unseen energetics of the divine masculine of the part of the whole, whatever part that will be, whatever collective that will be. And that is 60, that's number 64. That's Metatron's, that's Archangel Metatron. It's the star Merkaba. Now, you have to look into Nas and Paramein for this, and we will get better at this because I know we're going to get onto our sacred geometry. We don't know where the 64 comes from. I know one of us does, but we're not connected to them, obviously. I don't know if it's like the number of faces, the number of points, the number of sides. We don't know the structural integrity where that number comes from of the star tetrahedron, but Nassim Haramein has some amazing stuff. It was great. We've been hearing Pam Gregory quote him as well. So a Sagittarius, that's why it's really good, because Sagittarius for us just came out early at 5 that we've not seen. So we've set them for the same time that Cindy's comes out at 11, so that we can watch our little ones to see if they'll choose to watch her video or our video. And they're choosing to watch ours, which is great, because that's what we've wanted, because we're producing the material that's going to benefit them and others if they want to embrace it. It's for everyone. We do need to get clearer of our words, but that's what this practice playground is about. Yeah, we really like the end of the Leo one with the editing. And so Ophiuchus is above the scorpion's heart. And if we do our yoga mirroring, you've got Libra here. Libra here. And Sagittarius here. And then you've Ophiuchus at the top. The great healer, the serpent barrier, the serpent bearer, the carrier of the snake, the carrier of the collected, the carrier of the Kundalini energy. The Sagittarius, I'm pretty sure it's 27 degrees Sagittarius, because we used to think it was 14, is your galactic center. And there's strong energies around the galactic center on the... So... The external reality that we see out there is a collective of all of our individual projections. So if we want to create a harmonic global nation, we have to play our own part in that and create an internal harmonic subjective reality, so that our projection outwards of our subjective reality is a harmonic projection. And then that will create a harmonic global nation. So if the galactic center is got energies out there, then the galactic center deep within us is a real massively strongly potent magical energetic time to really, in an abstract logic or a logic abstract way, weave, which is what all of these tarot readers, whether they're consciously doing it or not, we don't know, but anything anyone says or does, which we then put back and mirror onto us, which is how we've got to become more co-conscious and get to where we are now from where we were, is their subconscious, their body, and the lower, denser, slower vibrations and frequencies, and the past, all data information written in the body, and the future, the superconscious energies, the mental body, because you have certain philosophy saying that the universe is mental. We see the universe as a singularity, as a particle concept. We see the multiverse as the many dimensions. It's the wave. So your Mexican wave happens because you've got lots of particles acting in a harmonic way, standing up to do the Mexican wave, because the universal and the multiversal laws of nature happen out to the macro, right down into the micro inside the body. And that could be the philosophy of the gut biome, the skin biome, the nose biome in the body of the bacteria of the body, or it could be the humans are the biomes of Mother Earth. Because I don't know if we finished it, the psychiatrist that let us out the psych ward said that what we're describing to him, he only words he found had for it was you're describing the tectonic plate movements on Earth. And we don't remember what we said, but it's like, yeah, that is it. So we're going to do offer yukas first, connect into the high priestess divine feminine, the whole, and the whole includes the masculine and the feminine. And the high priestess is number two, which is the feminine of the curved lines, and it has a line on it as in the masculine line. And we've got two viewers I can see now, so we're very grateful for you and appreciative of you, because we're creating a great triangulation now for us to be able to see the two, but then there's the three here. So, but the irony of this as well is, we loved it when we saw Tari to do this, but we were doing it ourselves first because our listeners had showed it us, and then we saw a Tari read, we picked up on a Tari reader doing it, because a lot of Tari readers don't like the Roman numerals, but two in Roman numerals is just two lines, which could look like the 11. And what came to us recently with the 11, because we're talking about cosmic justice, which is justice, your Libra, are the global axes, is your Libra energies that's coming into play. Is a cross between 11 and 8. So in the conventional understanding of the traditional tarot, which is the Rider-Waite, 11 is justice and 8 is strength. Whereas some people put 8 is justice and 11 is strength. So what's also come to us recently with that, within the last few days, is what we were going back to saying how society and all the factual evidence and books and academias, mainly the masculine within the masculine, it's going to be completely understandable that the Libra justice is a number 11, because that's masculine linear lines of the central channel, the Shishumna. And so therefore now a lot of people are doing the 8 as justice. And what we want to do, oh God, there's all these things that we want to do down the line. And then one of us is now going, oh, but we can't share ideas or our secrets. And it's like, it doesn't matter, because all of this is for the evolution and, more importantly, the involution of humanity to reach this harmonic state. So if someone steals our ideas, go for it, because you're probably going to be a lot quicker at us at this rate getting it out there in terminology. But it's, we've got quizzes and surveys that we want to do with questions, and because we believe that the people that are, it doesn't matter if you're male or female, the people that are changing the tarot into an 8 justice are coming from a feminine perspective rather than a masculine perspective. And we thought that was pretty, I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. Nice one, little ones. They honestly come out with so much cool stuff. So we're going to do offer yukas first, and we're also going to do an offer yukas at the end. But they're going to be like the how we do the spectrum of energies, the top of the back and the bottom of the pack. And so there'll be the opening. And Tita, okay, that's bringing us back to the thumbnail, because we learn so much stuff from the thumbnails. The thumbnails don't necessarily make any sense to what the video is sometimes, but afterwards it's like, oh, you're the personality that's communicating to us, because the us being the conscious mind, because we're missing something, and therefore we're putting all the pieces of these jigsaw puzzles together, taking one piece out from like thousands of jigsaw puzzles to put them together to make a very new, unique jigsaw puzzle together with no picture to go on. And Tita, Momo, Nainata! And someone passed the other day actually and said he was just about to do awards gig, as in WASGIJ, which is jigsaw backwards. We thought that was fascinating. My learns love the sound of that. We keep coming back to stuff and then losing it again, but that's the energy in the body. That's what it's like for us. And that's actually not just what it's like for us. That's what it's like for a lot of people we're observing. Which would make sense, because we see ourselves as a collective, because we've got a collective of us in this one body that have opposing ends of the spectrum. So yeah, it'd be great to put all these questions out and get a survey together and develop it, because we do ask very strange, interesting questions. So we're going to do the cards. We're going to read them in whatever format it comes out with. There will be the reading of the words. There will be the reading of the poems. So we're on ShintoSEYE now. ShintoSEYE relates to the present, so anything could flow through in the present, but it also relates to the yoga and the union of, which is the integration. Tita Pomama! Okay, we're going to do the yoga mudra for integration. So we're not going to give you the way to do it, because there's always a way to do anything, because that seems to be how we live in a society at the moment, and people seem to be more comfortable being spoon-fed. But we're just going to say, right, just get your arms, if you want to join in, and cross your arms in front of each other, one on top of the other. Now, if you're not good with listening to words and instructions, you can just copy us. But the idea is to just do it and see what habitual... Sorry, excuse that. My little one's lovely, look at them laugh. Releasing energy. Yeah, we are. Yeah, passing wind, top and bottom. Not bottom yet, but... Bottom as in the bottom, not bottom as in the bottom. So cross your hands over in front of each other, interlace your fingers, and just see what happens. So we've just gone like this automatically. So we've got our right arm underneath our left arm. Has the battery died on that already? Oh, that's a shame. But we had lots of battery on that. We've normally got it plugged in, but we've got the Ethernet cable plugged in. Okay. We've got Wi-Fi on, and we don't even know if the Ethernet cable's working. We're going to plug this in, and maybe it will charge up enough to start working. Because we want to show the cards. We do have the other phone just there. So, what's that signal thing mean? There's a signal thing now up next to the eye. So, it's a bit confusing technology. We'll get there with technology eventually. We've got this, we'll put that on in a minute if we can with the other phone.
We'll get there with technology eventually.
Yoga integration mudra. Oh, that's why it's all gone a bit crazy, isn't it? Does that mean it's not going to be a very good signal now and people aren't going to be able to see us? Can you still hear us okay? Can you still see us okay? I suppose we'll find out, won't we, when we have it back. We might have to do another live. Well, let's not charge that up. And let's just put that back in just in case. And we've got this phone here and we can just give that a go and put it on when we're ready.
Let's not charge that up. Let's just put that back in just in case. We've got this phone here.
So yeah, cross your hands over, interlace your fingers. And then what I want you to do is, so right now our baby finger is on top. I'm going to change it so that the baby finger that's on top now is the other one. That's my left hand. So now I'm going to change the cross and put that on top there. Oh, that's hard.
That's my left hand.
And then go back to the other way. So that's a bit easier. So if we'd stay the other way, it would have been really hard. So I've changed the habitual pattern and then I'm going to put it up here. You can see all our neck and our shoulders got compressed. Now, when we were showing this, first of all, it's just to breathe. And eventually there'll be some kind of release. And we're just like, what do you mean a release? And since then, we have all types of releases. They can be very volatile and spasmatic for us, especially that collarbone. And sometimes it can just be a gentle relaxation and anything in between. It's just a shift. And the best we can say is, if you don't notice anything, then there may just be those areas and networks in the body that just needs more attention, needs more love, needs more connecting to. We just need to fine tune our self-understanding, our self-learning. And our tongue goes to that gap and does all kind of spiral things as well. So we needed to do a shake and a sound to help ours. So we're just going to go out now, and then we're going to go back and swap the interlace of the fingers. The two that we had have gone. I wonder if this is too much for them. And then the baby finger that's on top, which is now our left baby finger, we're going to go back and put that on top on the other side.
And then the baby finger that's
switch it round so it's a bit easier and do it. It's so interesting that that signal thing's there and it's not been there before, and it's staying there now and not disappearing. It's just because it's not got much. And then swap the interlace again on your on your fingers. Okay, so we needed to do that. It's not making a... Oh, there's no... That side can go in, actually.
It's not making a...
Why did we take that out to start with? I think we thought that that was going to go in the USB, but it's a different USB, isn't it? So whatever we've just done, it's got the... It doesn't make a tit-tit noise. And we can't pause the broadcast or come back or anything, can we?
It doesn't make a tick-tock noise.
Okay, well, that is what it is. Just have to trust. Practice makes perfect. So let's invite ourselves on this phone and see if we can get a picture up. Oh, there might already be the invitation on this phone, actually. Okay, so I think that's going to work. Bear with us. It's starting to rain, and we've got to close the windows. we really think the signal's not going to be doing very good. Okay, so Why is the auto rotate not working? Okay, we're going to have to be doing the card in a very funny way. Yeah, look,
the signal's terrible.
We'll see. And the broadcast can come back.
We'll see. And the broadcast can come back.